massive microphone legend here! Today we're reviewing another microphone.
So today we are looking at this guy, the Aston Stealth, which is an active dynamic microphone. If you do want to pick this guy up, it will set you back around $400. Like always, I'll throw some links down below. And for this review, I have the microphone connected directly to the 2i2 second gen, 48 volts phantom power turned on, and the gain set at about 8 or 830. I will not do any kind of post-processing, but I may boost it in post, so check the doobly-doo to see what I diddly did. Now let's talk about what comes in the box. Of course, you are going to get the microphone. You get the odd mounting system, as well as a 5/8 to 3/8 inch microphone stand adapter, a fancy pin, some documentation, and a damn sticker! As far as the build quality, the microphone does feel pretty good. It has an all-metal body, but the head of the microphone is plastic, which is a little bit disappointing at this price point. Near the bottom of the microphone, you have a four-way rotating dial to switch between all four different voicings. The end that you speak into has a little bit of foam padding to assist with plosive rejection, and on the back of the microphone, you'll find the XLR port, the mounting bracket, and a button to turn on or off the lighting that is apparent when you have phantom power turned on or off. Then as far as the specs, this thing has a cardioid polar pattern, a frequency response of 20 Hz to 20 kHz, a passive sensitivity of around negative 60 decibels, an active sensitivity of around negative 16.5 decibels, a max SPL of 140 dB, a self-noise of 10 dBA, and a phantom power requirement of 0 or 48 volts, depending on if you want to use it in passive or active mode. And I do want to take a quick second to explain what the active mode is. They've built a Class A preamp inside of this thing, so when you have phantom power turned on, it activates that preamp, which functions exactly the same as a cloud lifter or a FET head, increasing the gain, meaning you don't need to drive your preamp quite as hard. Okay, up until this point, I've been speaking into the Aston Stealth on the V1 setting, which is made for male voices. That's what I'm currently on, and this is how the audio sounds. Now I've switched over to the V2 setting, which is made for female voices, and I did notice immediately that there was a big bump in the gain on this setting. But regardless, this is how the audio sounds on the V2. Now I am on the G setting, which is made for guitar, so I don't imagine that it will sound too good for my voice, but this is how it sounds for spoken word. And now I am on the D or the dark setting, which is intended to emulate a ribbon microphone, so it should be a lot darker, but this is how it sounds for spoken word. Okay, now I'm speaking into the front of the Aston Stealth. I will rotate around to 90 degrees to show you the off-axis rejection and coloration. We will continue rotating around the microphone to 180 degrees, show you what it sounds like from the rear. Continue rotating around the microphone to the second 90 degree angle, very nasally sounding over here. And then we will rotate and end at the front of the mic. Now let's go ahead and test the plosives. Please bring pizza pronto. Please bring pizza pronto. Please bring pizza pronto. Now I'm right on top of the microphone on the V1 setting. I had to drop my gain down to zero to avoid clipping, but this is how the audio sounds with the proximity effect. Now I am 3 inches away from the microphone with it pointed directly at the corner of my mouth, and this is how the audio sounds. About 1 foot away from the microphone, 2 feet away from the microphone, and about 4 feet away from the microphone. Now I am typing on a keyboard with Cherry MX Blues to see how much of my voice versus how much of the keyboard it picks up. Now let's go ahead and do a really quick test to see if the internal preamp on this thing adds any kind of coloration to the recording. So right now I'm on V1 with the 48 volts of phantom power turned on and my gain set at about 830 on the 2i2, and this is how the audio sounds. And now I've shut off the phantom power, meaning the preamp inside is bypassed. I increased the gain on the 2i2 to 100%, and this is how the audio sounds. So Aston states that this microphone has a waveform mesh head. This unique design provides shock absorption to protect the capsule with elastic mesh memory. So let's just go ahead and touch the boom arm to see how it does at rejecting any kind of bumps that occur near the microphone. Now I want to go ahead and compare the noise of the Class A preamp inside of the Stealth against the 2i2 with the microphone in passive mode. So I'm going to go ahead and throw the microphone in my soundproof Cheryl box, and let's go ahead and compare them. And finally, I want to do a very quick comparison of the Stealth against the SM7B. So currently I'm speaking into the Stealth in active mode on V1 with my gain set at about 830, and this is how the audio sounds. Now I'm speaking into the SM7B connected directly to the interface with my gain just shy of 100%. We are currently in the flat mode on the 7B, and this is how the audio sounds. The settings on the preamp are the exact same, however, I have enabled the presence boost on the SM7B, and this is how it sounds. And now I've shut off the phantom power, so the Stealth is back in passive mode. We are still on V1, and this is how the microphone sounds. There's a bunch of microphones out there. How will we test them in a way that would be fair? I just want to know which one is the best of them all. I know there's no actual answer, but gosh darn heckin', I really want to know! Sorry. Alright, well, I think it's pretty clear that Aston is throwing quite a bit of technology at this microphone, and I think it's yielded something pretty unique and pretty dang interesting. But first up, in terms of pros, the microphone does have a pretty good build quality, although at times it is a little bit difficult to switch between the different modes, and I wasn't too fond of the plastic head of the microphone. But other than that, it is an extremely versatile microphone with all of those different modes, as well as the built-in Class A preamp. And on the note of the preamp, I just think that is such a cool idea to throw in a cloud lifter or a FET head, or at least something equivalent to that, because that saves you so much money and it makes this microphone usable with any audio interface. And then in terms of cons, the microphone really didn't do a very good job at rejecting plosives or bumps of the table or boom arm. And I'm not the biggest fan of the mounting system. It just seems a little bit insecure, and it makes this microphone a little bit front heavy when it's on the stand. And now, as far as my overall thoughts on the electric guitar, I really liked how it sounded in V2. It just maintained a really nice and full low body without getting muddy, and it also had a nice amount of articulation and clarity up top. But if I was recording guitar for a full band mix, I think the G mode would be very beneficial because it does roll off a lot of that low end, making room for the bass to do its job. And I think a lot of people need to remember to do that. Let the bass do its job and let the guitar do its job. Then on the acoustic guitar, it's the exact same story. If it was a solo acoustic, I would still want to use V2 because that does have the body as well as the clarity and articulation. But in a full band mix, I think G would be the proper mode to use, even though it does sound a little bit funny when you hear the guitar by itself. Then for singing, I actually really liked how this sounded, particularly on V1. Surprise, surprise, that's the male setting. Who would have thunk it? I really think it sounded good, and I know I sound like a broken record, but it does maintain that nice body in the low and low mids, and it also has that clarity due to the big treble and air boost, which doesn't get overpowering or crunchy or harsh at any point, which was great. And lastly, for spoken word, I thought it worked really well and provided a very modern tone with that full low end and that crispness up top, and also having a tiny bit of recession in the midsection. It cut out some of those nasal tones, making it sound a little bit more pleasant. And all around, I just think it worked very well for spoken word. And now, would I recommend this microphone? Of course I would. If you're looking for a mic for your studio, this thing is just insanely versatile, and it would be an insanely useful tool to have in your mic locker. And then if you're looking at this for podcasting, I think it's a nice alternative to something like the 7B or the RE20 or any other dynamic microphone, really, because it does have that built-in Class A preamp, meaning you don't have to worry too much about your interface or standalone preamp having sufficient gain to drive a gain-hungry dynamic like the 7B. But if you're looking at this microphone for spoken word or singing or any application that would have gusts of wind going into it, 100% you need to pick up a pop filter, because it kind of sucks at rejecting that. Right, that is going to do it for today. So if you found this video fun, interesting, or helpful, go ahead and give me a thumbs up. If you hated it, give me a big old thumbs down. Want more videos? Go ahead and subscribe by clicking the logo down beneath me. And don't forget to hit that bell icon. Go hang out in the Discord server. I'll throw a link in the description down below. And I will see you all next time. Thanks for watching. Thanks for listening. Bye.